Okay, good evening to all of you. Now we are in the second presentation on this topic. Now, before I start, I would like to tell you a few things. One is, this is an exercise we are doing. We are doing to make this process, if it is possible, a success one. But in that process, I might not be very clear or something like that. So you should raise your questions, suggestions, remarks, either in the presentation or afterwards. You can also mail us in whatever form you want. But this must become a habit to us to ask questions. So that we will be able to clarify any doubts that we have in our new postulates that we are doing. We are not claiming that these new postulates are the correct ones, but we are looking at it in a form of understanding them. Now, what we are going to do is, we are first going to give you some new books and one of the oldest probably of presentations in this. So the three books that has come out in the last 2 or 3 years, last year and 2014, these are the three major books that have come out, where they are addressing the same similar questions that we are addressing of making this process a commercially viable process. The fourth reference is, even though it is put as 2007, it was put on online, but the article came in 1994. This article, if you can get hold of it. If you cannot, you please mail us, we will send you a soft copy. This will form the basis of all this photoelectrochemistry. So now, to recap what we have done in the last class, is the first exercise. What we try to do is, we try to emphasize that the photocatalytic or photoelectrochemical decomposition of water, we will come to it in the photocatalytic or not little later. We will assume that it is photocatalytic. We have already talked about it. Photocatalytic means particulate matter. Photoelectrochemical decomposition means hydrogen and oxygen are separately formed in two compartments. Whereas photocatalytic means the hydrogen and oxygen are formed on the same material. Now, we need not emphasize the promising steps towards generating clean and renewable alternative for fossil fuels by this process. So this is one of the things that we emphasized. Then the various attempts that have been made in this process, especially to make it in the what we call as band gap engineering, that is making the catalyst to be active in the visible light. In this attempt, we have, as in the last class, we have shown how titanium dioxide band gap can be changed, which is called the black titanium dioxide and all those things. We have not covered the literature. So what we have tried to do is, we said that the materials that are possible have been sensitized. It can be coupling, it can be doping, it can be second semiconductor or whatever way we are looking. So what we finally came to the conclusion is heterojunctions photocatalysts appear to be promising, but there is some problem in that. We will see this time that. But what we have tried to do is band structure and redox potentials matching of these two levels. Okay, that is, if the hydrogen evolution potential is going to be more positive with respect to the conduction band edge, and the valence band edge must be more positive with respect to the oxygen evolution potential. This is the general principle we use. But we only put this, and we use to show the redox potentials which are present in the vacuum semiconductor vacuum interface or any other ideal situations. What we have in reality is semiconductor solution interface. So semiconductor solution interface, these energy levels must be altering. How much it will alter and how it will be affecting is what we are going to see. That is what we call as the energetics of the band positions and the redox potentials. You should not think only band positions will alter. The redox potentials of the species also will alter. What we are talking is, for example, we take iron 3 plus iron 2 plus couple. We are showing the iron 2 plus iron 3 plus couple reduction. If we are looking at the reduction of iron 3 plus to iron 2 plus, we are taking the redox couple value that is reported in the literature at a particular pH, at a particular condition. But the redox potentials in the experiment may be different. So may be different means that we have to account for the pH variation and also due to the potential induced effect on the energy levels. We'll come to it a little later. So this is what we called last time as the dynamic nature of the electronic energy levels is postulated. Okay, this concept we try to introduce first time, but it is already existing only. It is not nothing new we are doing. Now, when we take the energetics of the photocatalytic or photoelectrochemical decomposition of water, okay, we will take the as though it is a photocatalytic, even though there are doubts about it. We will see later on. What we mean by that is photocatalytic means on the catalyst surface itself, both the reactions are taking place. Photoelectrochemical means the two reactions are taking place at two different electrodes. That is all the difference. Okay, we are not talking about whether this is catalytic, this is the energetic and all those things. What we are talking, when we talk photocatalytic, what we mean is the catalyst is in the ground state, reactant is in the ground state. Ultimately, the catalyst is in the ground state, product is in the ground state. So what is the potential energy surface? That is what we are talking. Now we will see this also in a minute. We have last time also shown this diagram. We will see this diagram also again this time. So why are we considering the energetics? We have already talked about it, that the hydrogen evolution potential must be with respect to the conduction band edge somewhat positive value or less negative value. Now, why this type of energetics have to be considered this time is maybe all the postulates are correct when this static situation is holding good, but when the energy levels are dynamic, then all these pictures have to be changed. So that is one of the reasons why we have not been successful. We don't claim that is the correct theorem, but we have to think about it. Then when we take this energy level diagram, what we are talking about is the conduction band maximum or conduction band minimum or valence band maximum. What we are talking about is the bulk semiconductor. But what we want is at the semiconductor electrolyte interface. At the interface, these energy levels will be so-called band bending will take place. What is this band bending? This concept itself is the terminology itself is wrong. But anyway, we will, since this terminology exists in the literature, we will use the terminology. What it means is the energy levels very near to this interface is altered with respect to the energy levels, similar energy levels in the bulk of the semiconductor. Why it is so and all those things, we will take it up in the next presentations or next in the coming presentations. Okay, because the double layer or whatever charge, space charge layer that we consider is skin depth in the metals, but in the semiconductors it is not skin depth. It will extends to few microns. So therefore, the the energy levels at the interface have to change. Now, it is not only the energy levels change, the energy levels also change with respect to the electrolyte concentration, the electrolyte pH, and also the electrolyte adsorption on the electrode or on the semiconductor catalyst particle. So how are they going to affect is what we have to see. So now if I were to see this, so this is what we have said that is the static potentials. So the valence band, this is the left hand side picture. You are seeing the left hand side, the semiconductor, the valence band maximum and the conduction band minimum. This is, that is why I have put the conduction band minimum very near to the interface as the dotted line. This is not the correct representation. In the same way, the at the interface, the valence band maximum also is not flat. Okay, that is why it is called flat band potential. This is flat band potential, but what we want is the potential is different here, depending upon how the, what is the pH of the medium, what is the concentration of the medium, how much of them is adsorbed. It can, the adsorption itself can vary with from the nature of the electrode. It cannot be the same for all the electrodes. Titanium dioxide might be, this is similar, different from any other semiconductor that we use. So what we postulate here is that the conduction band minimum must be more negative with respect to the acceptor levels or the hydrogen evolution potential. In the same way, the oxygen evolution potential must be more positive, less positive than the valence band maximum. So this postulate is already known to us. Therefore, we need not go on repeating it. We will keep it. But whether in the experimental situation, are we making sure that this is the case in all the semiconductors? That is the first question. Now, how it is varying is the question. Okay. So now here in this picture, we have shown, for example, a bulk semiconductor in the left-hand side. Then when we decrease the particle size from 6 nanometers to 2 nanometers, how the energy gaps are going to change. So, and then confinement width, that is the confinement width means the electron energy levels. That is all, okay, for our understanding, okay. It will be also changing. You can see that as the particle size decreases, the band gap also increases. Not only the band gap increases, the for example, the conduction band minimum in the 2 nanometer particle is different from the 3 nanometer particle, 4 nanometer particle, 5 nanometer particle, 6 nanometer particle. So that is, not only that, these wave functions also, the energy level changes means wave function also changes. That is why the reaction that is taking place on a catalyst surface depends upon the particle size. Not only that, if the particles are having a three-dimensional bulk semiconductor or two-dimensional layers or one-dimensional tubes or zero-dimensional dots, the density of states you can see varying. The density of states here is discrete energy levels. Here it is not, it is also discrete in the one-dimensional case, but it is separated by energy gap. In the density of states in the two-dimension, three-dimension, it is continuous, but it is smoothly continuous in three dimension, it is stepwise continuous in the two dimensions. All these factors have to be taken into account when we say the hydrogen evolution potential must be more positive with respect to the valence band, conduction band minimum. Many other postulates we will see later on. So therefore, what it means is, it is not enough if I were to define a solid solution interface, we have to also define what is the size of my solid and how to take the density of states, because the electron exchange is taking place between the density of states and the electrolyte. It is not, so if it is continuing in a three-dimensional case, the electron exchange can be facile, whereas in the zero dimension or one dimension, it cannot be as. So this is also a static concept. It is not a dynamic concept. Now this can, dynamic concept is, if I take this 2 nanometer particle, put it in an electrolyte of a certain pH and a certain concentration, and at that concentration, the adsorbed molecules are potentially distributing ions were to be present on the surface, the density of states will vary. Okay, this is the static density of states of your 2 nanometer particle, or one-dimensional particle, zero-dimensional particle, one-dimensional particle, two-dimensional particle, three-dimensional particle. This itself is like this. So when it is going to change with respect to my experimental conditions, the energetics of the electron transfers have to be modified. This is the second concept that we are introducing, that the so far that is used as the concept of the hydrogen evolution potential or oxygen evolution potential have been fixed, okay, pinned. We will see later on, pinning is another concept we have to come out. So they are fixed. That is not true. They are not fixed. Okay. So the band bending, that is what we are talking about. Band bending refers to local changes in the energy offset of a semiconductor band structure near a junction due to space charge effects. I hope you understand by space charge effect, because if the charge were to be exchanged between the solution and the semiconductor, there will be a space charge. There will be an excess charge of on one side of one particular charge. Because the common way to visualize the electron energy states and the Fermi level in a material is to draw bands on an energy versus distance plot. Okay, band diagram. Distance plot, we will see later on what is this distance. Okay, for the moment we will assume that distance is cm minus cm centimeter with respect to the surface. Band bending refers to bending of observed in the diagrams and does not correspond to any physical bending. The bands are not bending, only the energy levels are altered. Why the bending is put that is because we are representing a three-dimensional object in a two-dimensional diagram. Therefore, we have to show that the energy levels are not allowed energy levels anymore. That is why. Okay. Therefore, we have to see that it is a three-dimensional diagram which is drawn in a two-dimensional manner. The primary principle underlying band bending inside a semiconductor is space charge. This is because as soon as I bring an electrolyte and an electrode, there is a space charge that is created, because the charges will be depending upon the Fermi levels of the semiconductor or the solid and the solution, they will equalize. Therefore, equalize means the charges have to be flowing both directions. So therefore, as soon as I place a solid in a solution phase, it will definitely be that there will be exchange of charges. Now, how this charge is going to create an imbalance in the charge neutrality is the question. Okay, that is why we are talking about a double layer or like that. A space charge layer is for built up. Now, this space charge layer in a static system, okay, not a dynamic system, in a static system, it is governed by the Poisson equation. Poisson equation or any other electron emission equations. Okay. We will see later on what are the equations that are available. The Poisson equation gives a curvature to the bands where there is an imbalance in charge neutrality. Why is this charge imbalance? I have already told you, when I take a semiconductor particle, put it in an electrolyte, the Fermi level in the semiconductor and the Fermi level in the electrolyte have to become equal because of the equilibrium conditions. If Fermi level has to become equal, means the charge density in one of the phases must be flowing into the charge density of the other phases. Then only it can become equal. Charge density means it can be electron or hole. Although one expects a homogeneous material to be charge neutral everywhere, okay, on the whole it will be charge neutral because it is not charge system, but in the charge neutrality is on an average of over the distance, whereas what we are looking at is the at the interface. So therefore the charge neutrality condition cannot be applied to the interface. It can be applied to the bulk of the solution or bulk of the semiconductor. Therefore, practically all types of interfaces develop a charge imbalance, though for different reasons. Okay, we have already seen the charge imbalance can be due to the pH of the medium or due to the Fermi levels imbalance in the semiconductor and the electrolyte, or potential distributing ions, or whatever it is. We will call this as adsorption. We'll say potential distributing ions. Okay, let us assume that both are similar. So at the junction of two different types of same semiconductor, a p-n junction, the bands vary continuously since the dopants are sparsely distributed and only perturb the system. At the junction of two different semiconductors, there is a sharp shift in the band energies from one material to other. The band alignment at the junction, the difference in the conduction band edges is fixed. At the junction of a semiconductor and a metal, the bands of the semiconductor are pinned to the metal's Fermi level. We will see a few diagrams a little later. What it means is the Fermi level in the metal will be more. The density of states at the Fermi level of the metal will be more compared to the density of states at the Fermi level of a semiconductor. Therefore, the charge imbalance will be very high when a metal semiconductor interface or even in a solution semiconductor interface. Solution also can be approximated. A solution with a concentration of ions can be approximated to a metal, because the electrons are freely available. Electrons are charge carriers. At the junction of a conductor and vacuum, the vacuum level from the vacuum electrostatic potential is set by the material's work function and the Fermi level. Okay, Fermi level and work function, we'll see what is the difference between them. This also usually applies for the junction of a conductor to an insulator. It need not be only semiconductor, it can be any dissimilar systems. Okay, even two metals, this junction will be there, because the work function of the two metals may not be the same. Knowing now, bands will bend when two different types of materials are brought in contact is the key to understanding whether the junction will be rectifying. That is, if the charge is flowing freely, it is ohmic contact. If it is rectifying, the charge is flowing in only one direction, then it is the Schottky barrier. Okay. We will not worry about the terminologies. What we are meaning is, in one case, the charge transport from one phase to another does not meet with an activation barrier. In another case, the charge imbalance is created, which gives us a barrier. Okay, that is all. So therefore, the charge will be flowing in only one direction. In another case, it will be flowing in both directions, equalizing them. The degree of band bending depends on the relative Fermi levels and the carrier concentrations of the material forming the junction. In the p-type semiconductor, the bands bend upwards. This upward downward is not a correct terminology, but anyway, this is being used in the literature, so we will use it. What it means is, when the band bends upward, there is a barrier. When band bends downwards, there is a free flow. That is all what we can understand at this moment. We will see later on as we go along in some other presentations. While in n-types band, the band bends downward. Note that band bending is due to neither the magnetic field nor temperature gradient. Okay, it is only the free flow of charges. Rather, it is only arises in conjunction with the force of electric field. So therefore, whenever there is a solution solid interface, naturally the electric field is present. So we are only talking about the electric field. Photon field we are not brought it. If the photon field is going to be superimposed on that, or photon field is applied and then the electric field is operating, whichever way we look at it, it is not going to be like that. The electric field effect and the photon field effect will be simultaneous. It cannot be distinguished. But for our argument's sake, we will say photon field is first, second, then electric field is second. For understanding, then we will make them together. So this is the diagram. The band bending is what is shown here. I hope you are able to see. So therefore, this is the conduction bandage. This is the metal so semiconductor interface we are looking at it. So you can see that this is the bottom of the conduction band of the semiconductor. This is the top of the valence band of the semiconductor. Okay, I hope you are able to see. So therefore, the Fermi level is here in the metal. So therefore, even though the Fermi level in the semiconductor could have been here, it will get organized like this. It will raise or lower. Raise and lower is not correct. In the energetic positions, it will change. Okay, so therefore, how it is changing is here it is given here. I hope you are able to see. This is the work function of the metal. This is the work function of the semiconductor. Okay, so therefore, the barrier height that we are talking about is the difference in the work function of the metal and work function of the semiconductor. So now you can see that the charge transfer in the semiconductor to metal is very free flow. So therefore it is a ohmic contact, whereas the charge flow from the semiconductor to the metal is going to be experiencing a barrier like this, then it is called the Schottky barrier. So it all depends upon the psi s and the work function of the semiconductor. The magnitude of that will decide which one will be the which junction will be formed. So here I have shown before the contact is made between metal and semiconductor, how the energy positions will be present. Okay, so therefore the Fermi level of the metal is here, the Fermi level of the semiconductor is here. Okay, after we have made the contact between them, then you can see the Fermi level of the semiconductor and the Fermi level of the metal are equalized. So when I am doing this, so the charge has to be flowing from, because the Fermi level of the metal has to increase, the Fermi level of the semiconductor has to decrease, then only they will be able to equate. Therefore, charge has to flow from here to the metal. Whereas if the Fermi level of the semiconductor, the metal is higher and the Fermi level of the semiconductor is lower in energy situation like this in the weak class, then it will give rise to a Schottky barrier. Okay, so I hope you are able to understand. So this barrier that we are talking about is in units of the electron volts. Okay, so metal n-type positive potential, negative potential. Okay, the effect of the external voltage on the band bending of a n-type semiconductor metal Schottky barrier. So we are only looking at the application of the electric field on the semiconductor metal interface. Okay, so therefore, for example, if I were to take this, here the charge will flow from the metal to the semiconductor. Here the charge will flow from the metal to the semiconductor to the metal. This is what is called the forward bias and reverse bias. I hope you have studied them. Okay. this is what is the situation in the metal semiconductor interface. We have to now extrapolate it to metal solution semiconductor through solution interface, and also in the presence of a photon field. We will take it up in a subsequent presentation. So before that, we will see the is there any other way, this situation of a metal semiconductor can be put. What we are talking about is the interface is less than, say, let us assume 5 angstroms or less than 5 angstroms, less than or equal to 5 angstroms. Now, when I take that such a situation, okay, we are looking at the energy levels only at this 5 angstrom distance. We are not looking at the that is why they, I said these are all we are energy versus distance plot. Z, okay, Z is a distance. Let us assume like that. So now, if I were to look at the semiconductor, and if the semiconductor is a pure state, then it will have some acceptor levels here, very near to the Fermi level. So therefore, the electron cloud will be continuous here. Whereas here, the electron cloud cannot be continuous. So they have to surmount a barrier. So what it means is, the B schematic illustration of the origin of the metal induced gap states, namely the decay of the block wave function in the metal into this forbidden gap of the semiconductor. I hope you are able to see, this is the block wave function that induces an energy level in the semiconductor. We are not doping the semiconductor. Please don't think like that. The moment I am putting the semiconductor into an metal interface, the energy levels of the Fermi level of the Fermi level or the levels near to this through the metal creates additional energy levels which are acceptor for the electrons. Therefore, the block wave function now becomes continuous. Whereas here it is a barrier height is there. So now, if the situation is like this, okay, you need not worry about all this physics of this because it is a very complicated thing. We have to, but at least understand what is this. So what is the, okay, we have to talk about the direct gap materials, direct band gap energies is what is given here, okay, for these materials. Then the spin orbit splitting, we will not worry about it, n-type semiconductor. So what we are talking about is if there is a barrier, okay, in the interface, what will be the magnitude of the barrier? That is all what we are talking, okay. But here the barrier is, we are talking about n-type semiconductor, silicon and the p-type semiconductor. That is the type of situations we are talking about. So, okay. So these are the experimental barriers. These are the theoretical barriers. Okay, what it means, okay, quickly to understand this, what it means is that even if I have an interface, I have to put the energy levels at least 0.5 volts different from what we have in a static vacuum metal or vacuum semiconductor interface, because the energy levels are now at the interface. So the interface energy levels must be changing. An average, if you look at it, 0.5 to 0.6 is coming. Okay. Theoretically, when you calculate, it will be smaller than the experimental value. That is because theoretically we are assuming ideal situation, whereas in experimental situations, the ideality is not holding good. So what we have learned so far, that is all what we can do today. Junction of dissimilar materials, dipole charge at the interface, therefore your built-in potential is there. This built-in potential can be of the order of 0.5 to 0.6 volts. Relative band alignment between metal and semiconductor characterized by Schottky barrier height if it is charge is transferred from one to the other. Simple theory of Schottky barrier height does not apply. Must use exponentially determined values, because the theoretically computed value is for very ideal system, which is not practically applicable. The metal solid semiconductor junction charge dipole occurs at the interface. Typically, a depletion region is created. The charge is there. Let us assume the semiconductor to metal. Okay. For example, you take the semiconductor metal, the charges is put into the say, metal from the, therefore the space charges and the charges in the semiconductor side. So in the metal solution, metal semiconductor junction, charge dipole occurs at the interface. Typically a depletion region is created on the semiconductor side. Application of voltage to metal semiconductor junction impacts interface potential directly. So therefore, the energy levels at the acceptor energy levels at the semiconductor is altered. The same way the donor the electron energy levels in the metal also is altered. If this is the case, in the metal solution interface, it will be still more difficult. Modulation of depletion region with the width of the thing will be also with the voltage gives rise to a capacity effect. Okay, if the width is sufficient enough, it will give you a double layer capacitor or triple layer capacitor. But in an interface, we are talking about within the 5 angstrom distance. Therefore, within that, depending upon a 2 nanometer particle, the width will be about one angstrom or 2 angstroms only. If I take 6 nanometers particle, the width will be more. So now you see, it is not enough if I were to talk about the name of the semiconductor. We have to also talk about the particle size of the semiconductor and how the semiconductor particle is going to be affected with the application of the potential. Then over and above that, we have to apply the photon field. Order of magnitude of key parameters in silicon at 300 degrees, Schottky barrier height is of the order of 4.4 to 0.8 electron volts. So it all depends upon what metal, why such a variation you are looking, 0.4 to 0.8. For example, gold metal semiconductor interface, the barrier will be smaller. Whereas if it is copper, silicon semiconductor, the barrier height will be more different. So therefore, it all depends upon the metal and its nature. Okay, if it is an alloy, it will be, that is what is called a doping here. Okay, the metal itself is a doped substance, then its Fermi level will be different. So we will come back to these others. How the wave functions will vary is what we have to think. We'll look up it with next time. So now you can ask any questions you want. Mm-hmm.